let's talk about our American examples. We've talked about some theory, we talked about some international examples, etc. But let's talk about specifically our experience here in the U.S. with marine protected area networks. And let's talk specifically about the management issues with them. You guys should all know that very important date in terms of protected areas. We don't make you guys memorize a ton of dates in ESRM, but one of the ones that's very, very important is the founding of the very first national park ever in the history of the world. That was Yellowstone. That was 1872. And since then, we've had this whole network primarily of terrestrial-based protected areas. Our national park system is large, again, primarily on land, and has grown fairly steadily, and then after World War II, exponentially onward in terms of the amount of acreage. In 1903, we established our first refuge. So the park was to preserve the park and all that kind of stuff, but also scenic things, national park, enjoyment, national park, history of humans, all that kind of stuff. That's all within the purview of national parks. The national refuge system is, the units there are established to recover and protect species. So if there's some recreational opportunities or something, that's nice, but the primary motivation in that case is thinking about the ecology of the system. And that has also steadily grown. And that is that now actually exceeds the extent of area of aerial extent of our national parks. Quite large. In 1972, we passed the Marine Protection, Research, and Sanctuaries Act. This is a federal law. This is in the U.S. Congress. And that began our National Marine Sanctuaries Program. This is administered by NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. And these, and it said, okay, NOAA, you should set aside areas that are of special significance to either the resource or human use value. So this is more akin to the national park, right? It's not just for nature's sake. Could be to protect the fishery stocks in an area, something of that nature. But, and the big challenge with protected areas is this but. Also, so check out what we're supposed to do with these marine protected areas. Conservation, okay. Recreation, Ecological, okay. Historical, Research, okay. Educational, or aesthetic values. So all these things are on the potential palette. The more things we have to potentially worry about, the more potential conflicts, right? The simplest thing was if this were just to say conservation, have a conservation goal, or have a recreation goal, or have a historical goal, etc. No, this has multiple potential drivers and motivators for the establishment of these areas. And so that's not impossible, but that's just going to make the management that much more complicated. Because instead of having one group of stakeholders or one target that we're trying to achieve, we have potentially many. We have now 13, I have an updated slide over here. Okay, so this is the most recent slide. I've been trying to get more updated numbers. These are the numbers that NOAA gave me on Friday for you guys. I'm not entirely confident about them because they would say one number and I'd say, wait, but what about X? And they'd say, oh, yeah. No, that too. So I think this is accurate as of today, but I'm not entirely positive. We definitely have 13 marine sanctuaries. I'm showing those on the map here with these circle symbols, blue circle symbols. 13 marine sanctuaries, and these are only showing the center points. These aren't showing the entire territory. We also have two proposed sanctuaries. Those are symbolized with the yellow squares I have up there. And then we have two marine monuments. Now, in Hawaii last week, we went to a visitor center that was interpreting one of these visitor centers. So these, it's an interesting thing as to how you bin these. So these aren't technically sanctuaries, they're marine monuments, they're jointly managed. So it's not just the National Marine Sanctuaries Program that manages them, although they have joint management. There's Fish and Wildlife Service helps out, and there's potentially different agencies that are involved. So 13 plus two, and maybe in the near future, two additional, might be up to 15 plus two. All told, it's a huge amount of area. About 1.5, more than 1.5 million square kilometers. Huge areas. And I should have said the two that are the joint management are this Northwest Hawaiian Island and out here in American Samoa, the Rose Atoll territory. So again, here are the mission of our U.S. National Marine Sanctuaries. So resource protection. So hey, save everything, right? Scientific research. Let me just emphasize that. Scientific research. So you guys traveling out to count turtles, to count whales, that is supposed to be permitted, right? That's one of the goals. This is to facilitate you doing your scholarship. And then public education, to educate the public about the seas, fisheries, climate change, whatever the case may be. So to use these places as portals for education. And then in the mission statement is the phrase multiple use. So again, our classic challenge with the coastal zone is all of these users with potentially conflicting needs to be in there. What are some of the multiple uses? Well, potentially oil. No, don't want to have oil in there. But energy production, in theory, could be. Fishing, potentially, could be. Ecotourism with whales, could be. Right? And the list goes on and on. So indeed, in the specific mission of the sanctuaries is this multiple users, potentially conflicting a challenge of pleasing everybody at the same time. Or more accurately, figuring out how to make the correct trade-offs to please the most folks possible. A group has been birthed out of these. And now, again, as you mentioned last time, most of our sanctuary, most of our marine protected areas are small, right? They're postage stamps, they're relatively small in spatial extent. However, we do have this large or this increasingly popular approach of establishing these huge areas, right? And so the term that's being used for these are large scale marine protected areas. And one group, which is it's really an association. It's made out of volunteers who work at these different institutions. Essentially, it's a way to share information, create some shared research agendas, learn from each other, that kind of stuff. It's called Big Ocean, is the group. Started in 2010, and as of 2011, this was their map. So here now I am showing you actually the territorial extent of the marine protected area. And check them out, these are huge, right? Look at these suckers. They're very large. So this is the extent in 2011. And you see our Northwest Hawaiian protected area here as it appeared in 2011. President Obama expanded this now to all our territorial waters. And I should say, the light blue coloration here shows the territorial waters of a particular country. And so you'll note these things are all in the territorial waters, right? So right here, right up to the edge. Right here, right up to the edge. And now our sanctuary here is right up to the edge. And why is that? Why isn't it going to the darker blue color?
It's not water
control. It's international waters, right? So nobody has we could say whatever we want, but there's no enforcement ability for us to exert there, or some other country. In 2011, these were the proposed sites that were on the books. Okay, so hey, look at all, people are talking about adding all these protected areas, maybe expanding the existing ones, etc. And as of 2014, which is the most recent update to the map, this is what we have. So check it out, it looks great. Look at all these more and more areas in protected area status. However, if we look close, we see things like PIPA, the Phoenix Island area that we mentioned last time, which is essentially a paper park, has no enforcement. The Cook Islands, where we work, which, and this is showing all the southern areas, while it's been designated legally, they're still hashing out the specifics of the enforcement, right? So perhaps there's a bit of cart before the horse here with this, with these maps. And this is the most recent map. I emailed them for a more recent map, but they don't have one. But essentially, this is essentially the same right now in 2016, with the exception of this guy is expanded all the way to the blue lines. But clearly the idea of large-scale marine protected areas is catching on, right? Even if only in paper form, there's clearly some, at a minimum, rhetorical value, but in reality, a lot of people see conservation value for these areas. Next, I want to focus, is that cool? Any questions about that? Okay, yeah. So Danielle's question is, so what's my opinion of smaller MPAs? And I think they're fine. I think it depends on the species and the goal you're trying to protect. In some cases, you're better off having a series of, you know, small necklaces of protected areas, depending on the species and the management goal. In other cases, bigger is probably better. And so it's going to depend. Knowing nothing else about a specific site, I would err towards relatively larger areas as opposed to smaller areas, simply because, again, not knowing anything about the site you're thinking of, it's going to be more likely to encompass the potential habitat for the potential critter you're interested in conserving. But in general, we're going to have to look at it on a sort of case-by-case basis. So that's a good lead-in. So let's talk about what happened in California. So our current marine protected area network is now looked upon as a model for other areas of the world. Let's talk about what happened here. Starting in 1909, I should have said that previous stuff, all those sanctuaries and stuff, that was almost everything there is federal waters, right? This that we're talking about is state water. So that's going to be the stuff that's within 3 nautical miles of the coast. And in some places up to 7 miles. But so basically this is the stuff that's tight into the shore. Okay? So in 1909, we started establishing what we would now consider to be marine protected areas. And as if you recall from one of our previous lectures, around Catalina, hey, let's add this area, let's stop fishing here, and then they were rescinded. So we had this history of adding protected areas and then sort of, no, people want to fish. Primary motivation, fishing. Or concern over fishing pressure. From World War II to the 1980s, we added many different small pocket marine protected areas. Incredibly complicated. Almost on a one-off basis every time. So hey, this area, so where I did my PhD, one of the sites was a no mollusk collecting area. That's it. You could take fish, you could take lobster, couldn't take snails, and I worked on snails for my PhD. So one day, halfway through my PhD, some guy said, you know, you're collecting snails in a snail refuge. I was like, there's not such thing as snail refuge. Yeah, look at the map. And so you look, oh, damn, look on the map. Shoot, there's a I had to get a special permit to collect in there. In theory, right? There's nobody policing me, but I did. Other marine protected areas, you can take all the lobster you want, the abalone you want, whatever. No fish. Other areas, you can commercial fish, but not recreational fish. Others, you can recreational fish, but not commercial. And it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And some of them, it only applies to some time of the year. Others applies to all the year. So it's very, very complicated. It was very hard for even folks like me that were trying to follow the rules. It wasn't obvious where to, what was going on. Late 80s, people are starting to get worried that some of our traditional fisheries management practices, which primarily are focused on catch limit, size of your net, days you can fish, that kind of stuff, don't necessarily always seem to be working well. So people are looking for a new tool. The closure of the Grand Banks, the cod collapse, was crazy. Now, we have had some readings on this. We haven't talked about it very much, but it's hard for me to undersell the importance of this. This was one of the things that brought Europeans to North America. Salted cod fed people for generations. Salted cod was the protein of choice for people traveling long distances before refrigeration. Cod satisfied, we had 600 years of intense commercial exploitation of this stock. And then, in the late 80s, early 90s, it basically completely crashed. And that freaked people out. When you build civilizations around something that's been lasting on and on and on and on, and then all of a sudden it goes away, people start to get into a phase of re-examining and what's wrong. So this and other issues really start to raise the concern of fisheries collapse, that we're harvesting too many fish from the ocean. And so this idea of marine protected areas, of a spatial approach to management, starts to become popular. We have a lot of universities here in California. We have a lot of people that think about this kind of stuff. We then have, in the late 90s, we have the collapse of the abalone fishery. So when I was in graduate school, we used to eat abalone. So we would, so the guy that was taking pictures in the back here at the start of class before, so I used to work for him when I was an undergrad, and he was the grad student, and so we used to get abalone to eat. And it was like that, or spaghetti, or white sea bass, or lobster. That's sort of what we ate. And then, over the course of my graduate school, it went to the point where we could not collect any abalone anywhere in Southern California, which was crazy. My family, when I was young, my family up in San Francisco, we used to seasonally go and collect abalone as a family thing, so that we could have food to eat, during the year. So this loss of the abalone fishing. So what happened after 97? You can still collect abalone, but only on skin diving, only off free diving, no scuba, and only north of San Francisco. Everywhere else completely shut down. Commercial exploitation totally illegal anywhere in state waters. Again, huge psychological blow for people thinking about fishers. Like, what is going on? The cod collapse, abalone are totally gone. What's going on here, right? And when you guys that have been out in Santa Rosa, you've seen the massive, right, the massive middens out on Santa Rosa. Thousands and thousands and thousands of years, these relatively high populations of folks living on the Channel Islands, they didn't destroy the abalone, but all of a sudden they're gone. So again, I can't undersell the impact of this worry that was going around. So people were desperate for a new idea, a new management tool. My friends would probably say we weren't desperate, but I think there was a lot of desperate people. So then 1998, we had the International Year of the Ocean. You'll see this reference from time to time. You'll hear International Geophysical Year, all these things. The idea is, with these international years, people coordinate. They plan them a couple years in advance. They don't do them every year. It's every, couple decades. And everybody does a similar thing. The Russians do their thing. The Chinese do their thing. The Americans do their thing. The Costa Ricans do their thing. And we all collect stuff collaboratively and in a consistent manner to get a giant snapshot of whatever it is. In this case, the ocean, over that usually one year period. And so that starts people thinking about what's going on with the ocean. And that really helps jumpstart us into this era, which is what people were hoping to happen, actually, of thinking about different management practices for the ocean. So we have this National Ocean Conference, and that picture on the right is a picture from this. So it was held in Monterey, and then President Clinton and then Vice President Al Gore both came. And not only did they come, they came to our marine lab at Stanford, which is a little small marine protected area, super, super small, and they walk through the intertidal. So that's the picture on the right. They're walking through the intertidal, and they're talking with some grad students who were, you know, grad students when I was in grad school. And they basically had a huge news focus, right? So whenever the president goes anywhere, they have a huge soapbox, and this drew all this attention. And they were talking about, amongst other things, hey, why are there so many critters in the intertidal here? Well, it's because it's a protected area. People can't rip the mussels off the intertidal, you know, that kind of stuff. So that gave more momentum. The following year, the Clinton administration issues a national ocean report that has a bunch of different recommendations on all kinds of stuff, pollution and oil drilling and all this and that. And it includes a goal about marine protected areas. And they charged in the report that we should be establishing strongly linked, scientifically based, comprehensive networks that are representative of the ecosystems that exist in the various regions of the U.S. And then that leads to some other things. So there's also these other reports, probably most high profile, the Pew Ocean Commission report that led to a bunch of new policies about the ocean. And importantly, trying to think of the ocean management more holistically as opposed to haphazard the way it's historically been. Why does NOAA manage this? Why is NOAA part of the Department of Commerce? Everything else that we think about in terms of managing resources in Department of the Interior, right? USGS, Department of the Interior, National Park Service, Interior, Fish and Wildlife Service, Interior. NOAA, the thing that manages the oceans, out with all the people that are trying to drive more international trade. It's kind of strange. So the point is, this huge momentum is building up towards the late 90s to do something and do something different with regards to networks of marine protected areas. So this is my 1999 slide. It's very Prince. So the other context as to what's going on is a lot of, as I mentioned, this frustration that maybe our traditional approaches aren't working as well as we would like. A lot of evidence that many fish species haven't been doing well, and indeed many of them are going downhill. And a lot of the scientific crowd is pushing for marine protected areas. And a lot of the folks that are pushing for this are from my schools, the places where I was. So I had some inside view of this. At the same time, we had the rise of the dot-coms, which you guys probably won't remember because you're too young. But it was this huge boom, right? It was this huge boom, and all these guys got super rich. That's when Google became Google, and Yahoo became Yahoo, and all this stuff. A lot of money was generated. And so we have these groups like the Packard Foundation, really, I mean, they existed before, but they really got going in the 90s, in the late 90s. And they had a bunch of money to burn. And they wanted to make a splash. They wanted to change the world, make a difference. So they had a bunch of money that they could start to push towards different issues they wanted to pursue, and marine protected areas got their attention. So again, just to remind you guys, at the time, we had less than 3% of our state waters in some form of marine protected area. Most of those were small. Very confusing as to what can you do in them, what can you do in this one, you know, just very confusing network. I said at least 17. By some counts, there were 31 or 32 different categories of marine protected areas. So very, very confusing. Let me also say, it's not just confusing for you and I, it's also confusing for the enforcement folks, right? They don't need to know just one rule, they have to know all these different rules for wherever they happen to be. So it's a challenge. Okay, let's now talk about the Marine Life Protection Act, the landmark California Marine Life Protection Act. So we're talking about marine protected areas, MPAs, but this acronym is MLPA. So just so we're clear. The problem starts with the Channel Islands. So we're at the heart of the problem. So the idea was, hey, let's see if we can do something better. And because a lot of these folks, a lot of my friends worked on the Channel Islands, they're thinking about marine protected areas. Hey, let's start there in the Channel Islands. So, and you guys have read these papers. So we started to plan a new network, an expanded network of marine protected areas around the Channel Islands, California's Channel Islands, the northern Channel Islands. And in fact, those go into effect in 2003, or most of them go into effect in 2003, and they're slightly expanded to their current extent in 2008. But really, they start in 2003. This was a bad thing, I would say, in terms of management. In terms of setting area aside, it was a great thing. We got more area set aside, and it was great. And why were the particular areas place where they were? We're using all kinds of modeling, the best data we could figure out, and that this would be an effective way to conserve urchins and this and that. But I say it was a problem from the management side because we basically screwed the pooch. In many respects, we're still living with the unfortunate decisions that were made in the late 90s, early 2000s. So what happened was, we ticked off the fishermen. So what happened was, the scientists, and to be totally frank, I know you guys will find this shocking, most professors aren't good communicators. I know, shocking, I know, because I'm so fantastic, right? So most of us, in my graduate training, nobody ever told me not much instruction on how to be a teacher. Zero instruction on how to talk to the media. Zero instruction on how to talk to the public, right? So some of us that were interested in that tried to learn and try to school ourselves, but the system, our systems that by and large still exist in higher ed, in graduate school especially, do not tell you guys how to talk to the public. And that's now. So the professors that were professors in the late 90s, they went to school in the 70s, right? So there was even less attention to that kind of stuff, right? What were they schooled in? They're schooled in being the most kick-butt researcher you can possibly think, right? The best modeler, the best tracker of mountain lions, and all this kind of great stuff. So what happened was the scientists got together and they said, hey, here's the thought for what the marine protected area should be. And we went to public meetings in places like Santa Barbara, which is the epicenter of the problem. And all the fishermen came in, and the fishermen said, so you guys wanna make a marine protected area? Well, we think you should do it in spot X, Y, and Z. And the scientists go, oh yeah, thanks, but check this out. And they rolled out complete maps already done. So here we go. I hear what you're saying, thanks for that input, but you know, we modeled it, and actually A, B, and C are where we're gonna put them, because that's where the models show the larvae will collect the most. And the fishermen are saying, yeah, you're putting that right in my main fishing area. And then the other one is in my secondary fishing area, and the third one is in my tertiary fishing area. So you're saying I can't fish where I've been fishing for the last 20 or 25 years. And the scientist said, yeah, but the models say that would be better. And so the fishermen, I think with a lot of, understandably, felt they were not listened to, that this process didn't involve them. This was a scientist-driven thing for the scientists and the enviro community, and that was it. And so that burned a lot of fishermen, and a lot of fishermen said, this is baloney, this process is not collaborative, you're telling me it's collaborative, it's not, you've made all the decisions already. You're just trying to get us to rubber stamp what you did. That's not true dialogue. That's not true collaborative management. And basically, the scientist said, okay, well, we're just gonna do it anyway, thanks. And so they got the marine protected areas established around the Channel Islands. But then the rest of the state got screwed. So then what happens, we passed the California Marine Life Protection Act in 1999. And so this act says, hey, California Department of Fish and Game, which is what we called the department at the time. Now we call it California Department of Fish and Wildlife. But back then we called it California Department of Fish and Game. You should look at all the marine areas, state waters off California, and see what we should do. Let's overhaul this. So that was their charge. And fishermen said, no way. Veto. Massive veto. We saw what you guys did at the Channel Islands. We don't trust your people. You're not really interested in fishermen. You're interested in something else. And you're interested in driving fishermen out of the state of California. That's how you want to save the fish stocks, is just not have any fishing. The way you want to save fishing is eat all the fish from China and Indonesia. And you think that's good management. And so they were really, really ticked. And they, to this day, many of them are really, really ticked. So they basically derail that first attempt. Okay, so then we try a second iteration that tries to do things more supposedly collaboratively. That implodes because the state legislatures, so the fishermen talk to the state legislatures and basically there's no money. They won't allow them to spend money on it, so they can't do anything. So that fails a second time. Finally, in 2004, what's happened is we have a new governor, Governor Schwarzenegger, who comes in on a sort of very unusual. It was a recall vote of Governor Gray Davis, and Governor Schwarzenegger came in. Governor Schwarzenegger, even though he came in on a platform of cutting taxes and doing all this and that, he was a very strong and remains a very strong advocate for environmental protection. And he wanted to see this move forward. So it became one of his projects to help make sure this goes forward, appoint people that would support this. And so we essentially overhaul the process again. And we create the current process that we have, which is the so-called blue ribbon stakeholder group. I'll explain that in a second. And what they essentially do is say, we can't do the whole state. These interests that are really, these fishermen that hate marine protected areas and don't trust the process, will derail it. So instead, we're going to break the state up into different bite-sized groups and do each of those independently. Okay? And we're going to take some of the easier ones first and leave the most contentious ones, which is Southern California, towards the end. Okay? We're going to deal with that then. And so that sent us into a several-year process. We'll talk about that in a second. But between 2007 and 2013, we established this whole new network of marine protected areas. Essentially, all of state waters are now in a network of marine protected areas, except for the inside waters in San Francisco Bay. And that has to do with some legal stuff. But that's the last area that we've not put into the network. How did that work? We spent $38 million on this, only $18.5 million of which came from the state. The rest came from those NGOs that I mentioned that were all flush with cash and really, really interested in making a splash. So the only reason why this final version flew was because of that infusion of cash from the nonprofits, right? So they were able to get us through the political hurdle to actually do the creation of the network. Otherwise, this would have failed as well. So that establishment of the marine protected areas around the Channel Islands was very costly, I would suggest, in a management context. And it really helped fuel lots of distrust. So we see distrust in a lot of parts of the world when we talk about doing marine protected areas. But we saw that here in California, and we still see that. In particular, we saw that with fishermen. We also saw that with First Nation peoples, with a lot of Native American tribes, and how they were or were not incorporated into the process. And so there's a lot of sensitivity about that, and people felt like they were not being listened to. So this is what we ended up with. So again, this is a collaboration between public and private groups. And I'll show you the structure in a second, but geographically, this is what it looked like. So we broke the state up into different sections. So we started with the Central Coast. We then moved up to the North Central Coast. So the Central Coast is basically Monterey Bay area. and then down to San Luis Obispo, down to Point Conception. That's the yellow area that I have on the map here. Next, we started on the north central coast, which is essentially the outer part of San Francisco, up the Mendocino coast. Then we started on the south coast, but it was delayed for a while. But in theory, it was supposed to go from 2008 to 2009. It took much longer than that. And then the north coast. And then we're also supposed to do San Francisco Bay, but as I mentioned, that there's some legal issues where we can't technically redo some stuff to state waters until some other things happen. So it's a public-private partnership to create this plan. The plan is designed to meet the targets of the Marine Life Protection Act that we passed originally way back in 1999. The act was still in process. We just didn't have the tools with which to enact the legislation. So the goal with this is to indeed finally enact the goals of the Marine Life Protection Act. The process evolved over time, and it changed, and it got better as we went. If we had done the entire coast starting in 2004, it would have been a much different result potentially different result than what we ended up with. So we got much better as we went through time, and increasingly included citizen input and increasingly adapted the process, how that process would work, and increasingly made it more transparent so folks from the outside could see what was going on. And it became less in the scientist's lab and less in the back room, more in the meeting hall, in the meeting room. So essentially what we created for each of these sections was an iterative process. So it wasn't we sit here, talk, decide, let's go. We sit here, try to decide some stuff, and then we vet that around and have everybody give their feedback on it. And then we come back and go, hey, what did we think? Did we like A, B, or C? And then people say, oh my God, C's horrible, but we like B, and so then we kind of tweak B and on and on like that. The process evolved into one of gathering information, not the scientists going and telling the public what we should do. Scientists were key to this, absolutely fundamentally important. But the point was, we start with gathering information. Where do the fishermen fish? Where are the most important spots for whale watching? You know, and gather that in an open process. And then take that, and then use our modeling and economic trade-off models and this and that to decide what's gonna be effective. Very different from the Channel Islands approach. There's feedback all throughout through different levels, different groups, and a lot of the people that you know have been involved in one way, shape, or form. One of the key levels there is going to be the Blue Ribbon Task Force. So that is a bunch of scientists that mostly at universities that are sort of providing the overarching scientific check and making sure what we're talking about is rigorous and is passing the smell test, basically. But all these other groups are involved. And this process is done now. If this process was going on, you guys could be involved. And maybe you guys were probably a little bit young then, but was anybody involved with this process? Yeah, you guys are so young. But back then, you know, I took our class to one of the meetings, and you guys could go and participate and provide your input. Essentially, again, it's this multi-stage thing, iteration, and we have you know, folks gathering information, we fold it in, we go, we evolve. Throughout each level, we have public input, and the public will tell us, no man, this is not right, or we really like this version, or what have you. Ultimately, it was the California Fish and Game Commission that technically was the body that approved it. Everybody else was just making recommendations. Scientists were making recommendations, the public input was making recommendations, etc. But the actual, you know, codification is when the Fish and Game Commission voted on the formal enactment of this new network of places. We developed a lot of new technology that are now being used in marine protected areas and other issues around the world. So one thing we don't have time to do right now today, but I encourage you guys to look up and play with a sea sketch. One of our friends, Will McClintock's group from UCSB, really, really fantastic tool. This is essentially a Google Earth tool, which is they're now incorporated into ArcGIS as we speak. But it started with a sort of Google Earth-like interface and still remains a Google Earth-like interface. So anybody can come up. Your grandma can come up, and she could put in information. One. Two, she could see the key information that everybody else sees. The underlying economic valuation of the resource, the ecological communities that we've mapped underneath there. So we mapped most of the California coast for this process, so we knew which areas were sandy bottom, which areas were rocky bottom, which areas were kelp forests, etc. She could go look at that, but with a couple flicks, a couple clicks of a mouse. And again, when this started, this was Google Earth existed. Well, it wasn't called Google Earth, it was called Keyhole at the time. So the you know, Keyhole existed, but you had to pay for it. And so a lot of things that you guys take for granted now, these incredible dynamic maps on your phones, we didn't have that. So Seasketch really provided that. So it provided a geospatial way for people to give input. And then they allowed you to vote on it. So you could look at that and say, hey, we have option A, B, or C. So we went in this process from a bunch of crazy technicians like you guys, recent undergrads, that went and put up all these maps, printed all these maps in these hotel rooms, having these meetings around the state. And Joe Blow fishermen would go, I got something there. And like some, okay, scratch a pen on there. And then some tourist operator has a sticky note and goes, well, we like to take the boats there, right? And so then they finish up at 9 o'clock. And so then you guys had to take all those paper maps, run back to your hotel room, get a bunch of coffee, or I don't know what you kids drink, Red Bull you kids drink or something, and drink all your Red Bull, and then type all this stuff in all night long. Type, 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 digitize, type, 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 type. And then the next morning at 8 a.m., when they meet, you can show the new map. So Will gave a talk, I have it on our archive lectures, our ESRM seminar series from a couple years ago. So he gave a great talk. I'd recommend if you guys are interested in this, you go check it out. They've actually hired some of our students, if you guys are really good with GIS. But the point is, we went from doing a few hundred people providing input originally in the first iteration of this, to by the end, when we're doing the far northern California sites, they're getting 20,000 people, 30,000 people providing input and voting on designs. That's awesome. That's more democratic. That's more participatory. That's more people being involved with the process. The more people that are involved, they might not be happy with the outcome, but they're not going to be pissed off. Or if they're pissed off, they're going to be angry. They're not going to go cut your nets and blow up the dock and burn stuff down. When people feel they've not been listened to, it goes really, really poorly, right? So by being inclusive, this not only is good for a better result, but it also makes our constituents feel like they, not feel like, but actually make them part of the process. So they are being heard. And while everybody would like things to go their way, the key thing is to make sure everybody's been heard and don't have people feel like they've been neglected and they've been ignored and they've been made to think that they're stupid because they don't have a PhD behind their name or that kind of stuff. And that was kind of where we were when this process was starting in the early 2000s. This is our network as of today. So I've broken it down into different regions. And for our area, Now I'm showing it here in terms of no take, meaning can't take anything, versus all the different, I'll show you the breakdown in a second of what the different categories are. But suffice it to say, any protected area or no take is what I'm showing you in each of these. The first few columns are the number of total units. And then the second set of numbers is the aerial extent, the spatial extent of the areas. And we started in 1999 when we passed the Marine Life Protection Act. So that was before we started this process. 2004 was after we started the redo of the Channel Islands area. And so the only numbers that are different between 99 and 2004 is our south coast area. And again, that's from Point Conception down to the Tijuana border. So the only area that's different between 99 and 2004 is our area, because that's the only area that changed. And then 2013 is essentially our current state, what it's been since 2013. And then what I'm showing you over here is the proportion of total state waters. This is not all waters offshore. This is just state, jurisdictional state waters. And so we went from, let's say, in the South Coast, for no take, which are the most effective in terms of fisheries management, we've gone from 0.1% of our state waters in some form of protection, or in some form of no take, excuse me, to 11.7%. Huge difference, orders of magnitude difference, right? Two orders of magnitude more area protected in terms of proportionality. And if we actually talk about all the areas, we're up to a bit north of 15% of our areas. If we look at the statewide, similarly, we started off before this process at about 0.2%. So again, hardly any. And then by 2013, we're up to almost 10%, just a little bit south of 10% in no take. And if we talk about any form of protection, 16%. So that's a huge change. That's a huge change in the amount of protection. Is that cool? Questions? So here are, for Southern California, these are our four main areas. And really, it's the top three that are the new designations. So instead of going from that huge list of 17 or 30-odd or whatever, we're down to, in our case, basically three. There's a few more than three, but basically three. So if we have State Marine Reserve. And the next map that I'm going to show you is going to be color-coded, so I'm making the colors hopefully make sense to you. So State Marine Reserve is basically can't take anything, right? So that's the don't take anything. It's just the strictest restrictions. That's a lame sentence, strictest restrictions. Next is a State Marine Conservation. I hate the names. The names are totally confusing. So that was you know, state people did that. That was lame. But State Marine Reserve, State Marine Conservation Area. And there's two flavors of these. So there's a no-take State Marine Conservation Area, and then there's the more standard State Marine Conservation Area. The State Marine Conservation Area that's no-take, basically you can't take anything. However, they allow some ongoing impacts to go on. So for example, if we have a dredging operation, like near a harbor mouth or something that we've been doing for a long time, and it's permitted, that can still happen in a State Marine Conservation Area. Can't happen in a State Marine Reserve, but it could. So, right. Oh, sorry. Yeah, no, that's right. What I said was correct. Okay, and then the State Marine Conservation Area, just the regular one, allows some extraction. So most typically it allows some recreational fishing, but depending, it might allow some commercial fishing. So if you look at the breakdown there, They're fairly even between the State Marine Reserve and the regular State Marine Conservation Area, and there's many fewer that are State Marine Conservation Area and no take. And then we have two special closures, which basically have to do with essentially marine mammal haul-out areas where people, you're not supposed to go because we don't want to have people mess these with these species of concern. This is what that looks like. Here's our current map for marine protected areas in Southern California. Again, the red, the State Marine Reserve, is the most restrictive. The purple is the next most restrictive, and then we get into the other colors. So what you see is these areas that went in around the Channel Islands way back when, right? And we essentially took these federal water designations and brought them into the land. Those are the ones that are the most restrictive, the ones that were the most controversial. And you'll notice when we look up and down the coast, and so this wave really happened after that, you see much fewer red, a lot less red, right? More blues, more purples, more collaborative stuff, more, well, you know, let's do it like this. The other pattern you'll notice for us here in Ventura County, do you see any MPAs in Ventura County? Right. On the islands, but on the mainland, no. The only marine protected areas now in state waters for Ventura County are offshore. Why do you think that might be? Other than the fact that UCSB doesn't like it. No, just kidding.
Maybe it's history with oil extraction?
Okay, that's a good guess. History with oil extraction? No, because we have just as much oil extraction, if not more, up in Santa Barbara County. Yeah.
Is there a limit per county? How many MPAs you can have?
No, there's no limit per county. This was a process where we're shooting for 10 to 20%. And, you know, how can we allocate that? And, it was an iterative process. So it could have been a bunch or it could have been none. Chris?
More commercialized fishing.
Okay, so Chris's guess is more commercialized fishing. We have active ports, but no, that wasn't the reason.
The people on this area have a lot of money and they want to live on the coast and didn't want to have that interfere with...
Okay, so the question is maybe power, money and power. No, Santa Barbara has much more money and power than we do in Ventura County, and they have more marine protected areas. Yeah.
Is it just like the shipping?
No, not shipping.
Is it the water so polluted already? All the fish are pretty much.
No,
dead.
Not a pollution thing. Not a pollution thing. It's what, in the parlance of the debate for this, was habitat. It was the fixation, I would say, on rocky reef kelp habitat. We in Santa Barbara, how much of our coastline is sandy beach? You guys remember?
70%.
More than 70%. More than 80.
95.
Yes, it's in the mid-90s. So we're mostly a sandy coast here, right? The Oxnard Plain is a big alluvial basin, basically, right? That's why we have so many awesome sandy beaches here. So when people were doing the trade-offs, the diversity and density of fish is greater in kelp forests on rocky reefs as opposed to sandy shoals. So therefore, the quick calculus was, hey, not too many exciting areas here, don't need to protect this. Even though we now know that, for example, we have a big barred sand bass, what appears to be a reproduction area, breeding area, off of the Ventura Harbor that wasn't protected. So it has to do with folks thinking that sand is ubiquitous and sand is cool. We don't need to protect sand. Sand is cool. We need to protect the rocky reefs. So we'll see over time as to whether this sticks. The other thing, as we said last time, that the ultimate is to completely delete all of the existing marine reserves and start over from scratch. We didn't do that here. I mean, in theory we did. We tried some models. But politically, what always won out was Naples, an area that researchers have been studying for a long time. Point Dume, which was an area before. So we used to an extent, we used the existing areas, right? And in some cases, there were good reasons for that. In others, well, you know, we've had this area shut down. We want to see what's going on. So there was also political trade-offs that led to the network that we have. And it wasn't necessarily the one you would completely predict based purely on the science. Again, this is a public process. So in some cases, people wanted to protect, for example, people wanted to protect around here their kelp harvesting for abalone farms. And they didn't want that stuff to go into a marine reserve because they need some place to collect kelp. If we're gonna farm abalone, we need a place to collect that stuff. So there's various interests that are balanced in this. And some people would say balanced well, other people would say weren't balanced well, but this is the network that we have. This is our Southern California Marine Protected Area Network. I would also say it took this, so this went into effect, you know, 2012, 2013. It took them until about a year ago for you actually to be able to easily see this on your mobile phone. So the communication is still lagging. There's still problems with this process in terms of communicating to the public, educating the public what's going on. The takeaways from our California Marine Protected Area planning process were that, one, it was costly. As I mentioned, $38 million. We're fortunate in that we're a wealthy state. We could afford to burn this. Louisiana, they're not gonna spend that. They're not gonna spend tens of millions of dollars in a planning process for areas offshore. Developing nations don't have that kind of money, so it was costly. It took about a decade longer than it had to because of the unfortunate decisions and burning of interest groups. Importantly, it burned a lot of capital. That process burned a lot of my capital with certain people. So in certain areas now, when I go in and say I'm a university professor, they go, jeez. Well, people already say that anyway, but they, oh, geez. So the story I always tell is at the five-year anniversary? Yeah, I think it was a five-year anniversary of the Channel Islands Marine Protected Area. We were having a meeting, and people were presenting the data that we had to date, talking about the efficacy of the Marine Protected Area. And I was sitting in the back, and there was some fishermen sitting in front of me. And so this was a public forum. Anybody could come. And so, you know, because it was about their livelihood, there were a lot of fishermen there, understandably. And so scientists were going up, giving their 15-minute talks, giving the update on how many lobster there are, how many sheephead there are, or whatever it was. And this one researcher was presenting data and had a crappy slide, quite honestly. Lame slide. So it was a slide over time showing the... I would show a picture of it, but I don't want to get anybody angry or in trouble. Suffice it to say, it was what was changing over time. And there were two lines. And one of the lines was what was the trend in the protected areas and then in the areas outside there that folks had been monitoring. And they were trying to say that, look, we're seeing a lot of the stuff is going up, a lot of stuff is going down, but it seems like it's going up slightly more at the time in the protected area. Protected areas. And if you guys went to the island symposium, you saw more data like that a few weeks ago. So the problem was the guy didn't label his years properly. He didn't properly label his time axis. And so these fishermen sitting a couple rows in front of me, I see this fisherman. He turns to the other fisherman. He says, what year was that? And the other fisherman says, I don't know. I can't tell. So the guy raises his hand. And he said, yep, raise his hand. And so the guy's speaking. And the gentleman keeps talking and is ignoring the guy. And then the guy starts waving his hand, so it becomes very, very obvious that this guy wants to say something. And so then the speaker paused and said, yeah, sorry, was there a question? And then a guy from the California Department of Fish and Game jumped up and said, no questions. And the fisherman said, oh, no, I'm not trying to ask a question. I just am trying to figure out, and the guy from the state says, no questions, we said. No questions. Later. And the fisherman said, look, I'm just trying to ask. And the guy from the state said, I said no questions. Security?
Oh, my God.
And then the guy in the fisherman says, F you, this whole process is BS. And he said, hey, jackass. I was trying to ask if that data started in 1997 because you showed a spike, and I was trying to figure out if that was an El Nino year. But, and then he said a bunch of swear words. He said, screw you. You guys don't want us to understand what's going on, right? And he stomped out of the room. And so that was really emblematic of what this process had created, I think. It's getting better. Over time, it's getting better. But what happened was, it's completely understandable what happened, right? The gentleman talking up there didn't see his hand. And then when he saw it, he tried to answer him. The guy from the state had dealt for so many years with angry and upset fishermen that were disrupting processes. He was saying, he thought, incorrectly but understandably, he thought that guy was trying to derail the presentation with some kind of thing. The fisherman was trying to participate, right? The fisherman was trying to understand what was going on, but he couldn't understand. And because the slides weren't great, nobody could really understand his question. If he had just been allowed to say, is that 97? And the guy said, yeah, that's 97. Go, okay, thanks. They probably would have gone on. It would have been no problem. But that's not the atmosphere that was created, especially in Southern California, especially in the Santa Barbara area. Really, really problematic. And so that burns capital, right? So I and other people have to work that much. You guys have to work that much harder now because of that legacy of poor management or poor collaborative decision making. Over the process, we developed a lot of cool technology, like C-Sketch, other things too. A lot of great models to predict how larvae are going to move and disperse and all that kind of good stuff. And then, key, that story I just told you, environmental communication firms. So what came out of this process, because of this distrust, and it's used on many, many, like the seafood stuff I work on, all this stuff, and it's actually a vast improvement. Rarely now does the guy from Fish and Game run a meeting. Rarely do the scientists run a meeting. Instead, as part of the budget, we hire an environmental communications firm. And those environmental communication firms are specialized, they're like you guys. Maybe some of you guys are interested in working for these firms. So they have an environmental science background, maybe a biology background, whatever. But their goal is to make the meeting go. If we're having a decision here, they're gonna make sure that everybody here in the room has a chance to speak. If Joanna's not talking, they go, Joanna, are you sure? Are you good with this, right? If somebody like me, who talks a lot, is talking too much, like, thank you, Dr. Anderson, that's great. Yeah, thanks. Can you like just be quiet for a second? I wanna hear from Greg or something, right? And so that's their job. Their job is to make sure everybody is heard. Nobody dominates the meeting. Nobody, you know, railroads with their agenda. And it's made a massive improvement in the collaborative process. So environmental communication firms really, really came into their own in California during this process, I would say. Really, it helped us talk about the value of true engagement and realizing we can't get everything we want. Right? In the presidential debate that's going on right now, you're hearing everybody say, well, I'm about this. That's not how it works in a state of 37 million people, in a country of 340 million people, right? You can't just do what you want to do all the time. You need to make trade-offs. And that means you need to trust people, right? So they need to trust me, I need to trust them, that when we work collaboratively, you're not gonna go around and stab me in the back, right? So it requires us to work as adults and work as partners. Nothing is perfect, and one of the biggest problems we have here with this process is some things that got left for afterthoughts, I would say, that weren't really formally baked in from the beginning. The first is so-called adaptive monitoring. We put all this, you know, tens and tens of millions of dollars in the planning process, we have very little money for monitoring. We have essentially $5 million to monitor all these things for a five-year period. It's not a lot of money. The entity that we spun up, which is this quasi-public NGO thing, it's called the MPA Monitoring Enterprise, that's part of the Ocean Protection Council, or affiliated with the Ocean Protection Council. That didn't formally stand up until 2007, and it took them a while to hire staff. So the entity that's doing the monitoring comes after the planning. That's not good. One of the things we've learned is you want the design of the monitoring to go hand in hand with the design so that that can better feed back into the iteration. This process that we're doing requires evaluation every 5 years. Well, not every 5 years, but after this. Okay, so ours went into effect in 2012, right? Every 5 years, we have a meeting. We're supposed to look at it. And in theory, we can redo the marine protected areas every 5 years, in theory. So if we find they're not working, we could adjust the boundaries, or we could change the designation, or what have you. So that's great, but the problem is we just don't have a huge amount of data to do that, and the state doesn't have a robust budget to support that. So that's an afterthought. Lastly, I would say we did a good job with the community engagement, but not a perfect job. And I'd say some of the folks that were most, aside from the fishermen, even though the fishermen were angry, we worked really hard to integrate the fishing community. Recreational and commercial fishing community. They both had problems at times, but especially First Nation people, Native peoples, were not necessarily as involved with the process as they would have liked to have been, and their concerns weren't necessarily incorporated as much as they could have been. And that's a traditional problem here in California. And then I would also say a lot of the process was run by our research universities, which are great things. We're very blessed to have those wonderful institutions. But sometimes we are a little too focused on the so-called R1 universities, and we might have benefited from perhaps some additional diversity of other institutions doing stuff. In general, to finish up this MPA discussion, the general rules from the reviews and the lessons, somewhere between 10 and 30% of our ocean area should be in some form of marine protected area, is the general rule of thumb. Ideally, we'd like to design a network of these protected areas in a way such that we have representation of all the different ecological elements, sand as well as rocky, as well as whatever. Uniqueness, so things that only occur in a very few places, maybe a pinnacle where wrasse spawn. You know, let's make sure we capture those areas. The true movement, we talked before about the movement and how widely dispersive these critters are, how much they move on a daily basis or monthly basis. And so we want to have that there. And all that folded in with true stakeholder engagement, right? So again, asking the public at the start of the process, what are their concerns, what are the areas they're most worried about, et cetera, is key. In general, we need less area set aside in a protected area if the resource is well managed. If the fish population is honking and doing great, we don't need as much area relative to a fish population that had been massively overfished and is very few individuals left. In general, we usually don't start establishing these reserves until we're in that depleted state. So that's the other thing, where sometimes people want these reserves to work instantly, and while they do seem to be working in general, you know, we're starting from a bad place. So it's going to take more than just the quote-unquote average or best guess time probably to see the recovery, because these organisms are so impacted. California's Marine Life Protection Act is I think widely considered a very important example. There are increasingly other examples that are starting to supersede it around the world, but still it was a very important thing to show that you can do it with all stakeholders. A lot of the technologies and tools and approaches that we piloted here are being used elsewhere and being refined elsewhere. So that's really cool. You should be proud of that. We have to include monitoring and continual assessment in these things. The notion that we can establish Yellowstone and walk away is an incorrect, it was never correct, but is absolutely not correct now. So we have to fundamentally incorporate monitoring and assessment into the design from the get-go. And then lastly, outreach and enforcement really need adequate funding, right? We heard that with the crocodile stuff. How are you gonna get money to do this? We can make the most awesomest network in the world, but if we don't have the money for the rangers to enforce that designation, it doesn't matter what we're gonna do, right? It's gonna be a paper park, like in Pippa or those other places. So if you can't enforce, if you can't fund the proper enforcement, don't bother starting, in my opinion. So lastly, just to reiterate a couple last things that we already talked about, the idea that species movement is important. So if this is the area we're talking about and the brown fish move, they're probably going to be protected. The green fish, a lot of those green fish are probably going to be okay. Some are going to move outside, but a lot of their territory is within inside, so they're good. But the halibut here, the bluefish, aren't going to be particularly well protected, right? Similarly, this notion, you guys should remember this notion of connectivity, that's driven by the fact that we have these bipartite life history strategies for many of the critters we're talking about. We have dispersal of the young life history stage, and where the young or those life history stages move a lot farther often than do the adults. But then the adults might also move themselves. We refer to that typically as migration when they're adults. This notion of that Daniela asked about, this notion of what's the best formula? And the answer is there is no best formula. It's going to depend on the site, whether we want to do a single large reserve or a network of smaller reserves. And then again, lastly, enforcement. So here's a bunch of abalone that have been illegally poached up in Northern California, taken more than their limit. Again, if we can't at least reasonably expect some enforcement, we should really think about whether we should put this type of management tool into place, because it will almost assuredly be doomed to failure. There you go. You got some pretty fishes. So when they work well, we got fishes like these chromas here.